certainly a joy to be part of the church. The church that, indeed, as the song goes, is sometimes crying and other times we're victorious. And we spread the gospel of Jesus Christ and we stand behind one another and others in our community. And well, we just are grateful for all the ways that we can be in ministry in your name and for all the ways that your Holy Spirit helps to move us on and to do the work that you have given us to do. But we certainly are grateful for the times that we spend in fellowship with one another. We thank you for the great success of the yard sale yesterday and are just thankful there that at the root of all of that success is the way that we can come together and work together well. And for that, we give you thanks. We thank you for the youth and for their work yesterday and are grateful, God, for their willingness to help others. We're thankful for birthdays and celebrations and your faithfulness to us, Lord. And we're grateful, Lord, as we think about those who are traveling, that Zane arrived in Germany safely. We're grateful for that and pray that you be with him during his time there. And Lord, we look at the list in our bulletin and we see very many people in our community and beyond who are in need. Today we have lifted up the names of Howard Baldwin and Gina Shell, Levia Kramer and Jerry and Cindy Bain. Those who here on Penn Street were victims of a fire this week. We pray for Elena that she might get a job closer to home. We pray for Greg Shoemaker as he begins treatments. We pray for Bill Weinslager in his battle with cancer. We pray for the soldiers who were injured and for the loss of life in California. For Austin as he leaves for the Navy. We pray for those who were victimized physically and emotionally, both in London and in Manchester in these past weeks. We pray, God, for all those who travel. We pray for Amy. We pray for our pastors and churches in the midst of transition. We pray for Amanda Scheller. We pray for our annual conference this week for those who travel to Grove City. We are thankful, God, for a time when we can come together from all places of the conference and be together to worship and to be about the church's business. And we pray, Lord, that we might know the presence and the wisdom and the discernment of your Holy Spirit as we meet this week. God, these are the concerns of our hearts this day, and we put them in your very capable hands, asking that you would bring healing where it's needed, that you would bring comfort. And most importantly, God, we pray that you would not only strengthen and encourage those who are in the midst of difficult times today, but that they would know your peace and your presence to be with them. God, we do thank you again for the work of the church and the gift of your Holy Spirit. And we come together now as Christ Church praying as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. This morning we turn to the book of Acts chapter 2, the first 21 verses, as we read Luke's account of that very first Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were standing in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, the crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites? residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said they have had too much wine. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Will you pray with me? God, we have read and heard about the giving of your Holy Spirit to those disciples in an upper room so long ago. And God, we pray now that your Holy Spirit would be at work within each of us. We may hear your word for us today. That we may know what it is that you have called us to do. And that we may call upon your spirit to enable us to do those things. God, we pray that the meditation of our hearts and the words of my mouth would be accepted. Amen. Do you have any idea what you might be doing 50 days? 50 days from now will be July 24th. It'll be in the mid-summer. You'll be wondering how quickly summer is passing by. Maybe you'll be on vacation. Maybe you'll be thinking about going on vacation or returning from vacation. Then I would ask you, do you remember what you were doing 50 days ago? 50 days ago was Easter Sunday. We were all gathered here, worshiping and celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Jews celebrated Pentecost, which was also known as the Festival of Weeks. It was a harvest festival. It was also a time when they remembered the giving of the Ten Commandments at Mount Sinai, which happened 50 days after they escaped from Egypt. It had been 50 difficult days for the disciples. There had been a mystery and the astonishment of Easter. Jesus appeared to them several times. 40 days after Easter, Jesus ascended to heaven and told them to wait for what God had promised them. And Luke tells us that they returned to Jerusalem with great joy, that they were constantly in the temple praising God for all that they had seen and had done. But I have to wonder, that if at some point their joy didn't turn into impatience and frustration. They had no idea exactly what God had in mind. They really didn't even know when it might happen. And I would have to think that every day they would have gotten up and thought, well, maybe this is the day. And when that day had passed and nothing had happened, then maybe they got a little frustrated and thought, well, maybe tomorrow will be the day. Well, finally the day had come on Pentecost. And they found out what God had promised them. Jews from all over were in Jerusalem for the festival. There were 120 people gathered together in a large upper room. And they were waiting and waiting. Waiting for something very special to happen to them, even though, as I said, they weren't quite sure what it was that was going to happen. What they were waiting for, we know, was for the Holy Spirit to come upon them, to come into them. They had no idea what that was going to mean for them. And then, as they were gathered, it was like a rush of wind into the room, and the Holy Spirit came into their lives. It was like tongues of fire above them and tongues of fire within them. who was gathered there, from all different nations, as I just read to you, all speaking different languages, were able to understand what the disciples were saying. And that fire continued to burn. And the gospel spread from house to house, from village to village, from community to community, and from nation to nation. It was like a brush fire burning across the field. And so it continues for 2,000 years. The Holy Spirit empowers the church to continue and to grow and to spread the gospel. So that's what happened at that Pentecost in Jerusalem. What does that really mean for us? It's exciting. It's monumental. It's life-changing. But truthfully, it seems hard to understand. So I decided to preach on Pentecost this year about how it relates to what is happening in our lives as a church. We are in a transitional time, an in-between time. We're kind of like those disciples. Something is ending. Something new will be beginning. And we're not sure exactly what that means. Every Sunday, when I pronounce the benediction, I use the words that are 2,000 years old. I offer you a final blessing as worship ends, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. When someone is baptized in the church, we do so in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. When I preside over a funeral, the final committal prayer is given in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So the truth is that we talk a lot about the Trinity in our life together, which is to say that we talk about who God is and what God does. God the Creator, the one who gave us life, the one from whom we come. His Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, the revelation of who God is. And then we know that there's this third one we talk about. Have you ever worked with someone that you're really not sure what they do, but somehow you know that they're really important? That's how a lot of Christians view the Holy Spirit. We know the Holy Spirit is important. We know the Holy Spirit is, in fact, God. But unlike the Creator, unlike Jesus Christ, we don't quite know what it is that the Spirit of God does. I will tell you that in the original Greek, the word for Holy Spirit is paraclete. Not that you need to know that or to remember that. But I think it is important to know what that word means. And it literally means to call beside. So in other words, God is calling the Holy Spirit to be beside us, to comfort us, to encourage us, and to guide us. And unlike Jesus, who can only be in one place at a time, the Holy Spirit can be with us everywhere and always. Now, it had to be unsettling for those disciples to know that Jesus was no longer going to be with them anymore. They no doubt were trying to imagine what their life without him was going to be like. You and I know a little bit about that. Have you ever thought to yourself, this whole faith thing would be a whole lot easier if Jesus would just come down here and tell us what it is that he wants? I have to say that I have thought. Whenever I have a big decision to make, I wish that I could just ask Jesus, is this what you want me to do, and then to get an answer, yes or no. I asked that question before I went into ministry, before I moved here, and yet again a few months ago, and many, many times in between. And maybe you can relate. Maybe you have been faced with trying to figure out how to live as a Christian in this world. And you've had some decision to make, or some hard thing to grapple with, and you've wondered, God, where are you? And why aren't you right here telling me what to do next? I have to tell you, that's how I felt when the bishop called. I didn't know she'd been trying to call me for 3 days. It was coming up as unknown. she was out of the country. Until Alan Brooks called me at 6:30 in the morning and wondered why I wasn't answering the bishop's calls. I said, she's not calling me. Well, she was. And because of the problem, the days had been passed. She needed to know, like in 36 hours, what my decision was. It was a difficult 36 hours. There were times when I felt like Jacob out wrestling in the desert with God for an answer. And I was doing that very same thing. God, just tell me what it is that you want me to do. And then I truly felt that I heard God saying to me, I'm answering your prayer. Because you see, way back last fall, Al and I had talked about the good possibility that I would be moving this year. As unsettling as that was, I found peace in praying every day. God, just put me where you need me to be the most. And where I'm going to be loved. And finally, I remember. God was not answering my prayer in any way that I had ever imagined or wanted. But he was, in fact, answering my prayer. And then there was a whole concern for me about who was going to follow me. Who would be that person that I could entrust each of you to, as well as the work of the co-op, which is so very important to me. The cabinet met the week after that, were no real answers. Asking someone to pastor 7 churches is rather intimidating. I came home from a cabinet meeting and Bud and I had a conversation whereby he told me that his work situation had changed drastically and that he felt that, you know, if the opportunity presented itself, he was ready for full-time ministry. I sat there in the office, not letting on to him because I didn't know exactly what was going to happen, but I saw God's handprints all over that. And I called Alan, and we decided and talked about it and thought that we would bring God's name before cabinet, which we did following me. We prayed over it, and we called him. Alan and I both got a little worried when there was this dead silence on the other side of the phone, and then God told us he would call Don. But yes, he called me. I share that with you to help you understand that that's the best way that I can describe the work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was there, guiding and directing, and working things out in God's perfect time. But I don't believe that the Holy Spirit can only be found in church. I believe that we can call on the Holy Spirit in every situation of our lives. And if we listen to what God is telling us, we will feel God's peace. And maybe you have felt that in hard times, when you've had to make very difficult decisions about your life or the life of someone you love. Or when you've had to end a relationship that didn't feel like the place that you should be anymore. Or when you had to leave behind something that you once loved and turn instead to something new. Maybe you've had that in happy situations too, when you had to choose between 2 job offers, when you had to choose the person that you were going to spend the rest of your life with, or maybe when you stood at a crossroads and really both options looked good, and you wish God would just tell you which way to go, which is the next right step to take. We've all been there. It's called being in discernment. A time when you sort through your options. And we can make this time holy by calling upon the Holy Spirit to show you where God is leading you. I believe with all of my heart that God led you here 9 years ago. And I believe that God's Spirit has made the pathway of where I go next. I will also tell you that I am very overwhelmed, not only by the job ahead, but by what it means to have to move. And there's a great deal of sadness within me in leaving all of you. But I have peace. Because God always knows best. And God has never let me down. So I just pray that you would pray for Pastor Bud and Pastor Cindy and all the churches in the co-op. would call on the Holy Spirit for guidance, that you would move through this transition with open hearts and open minds, with a willingness to allow the Spirit to lead you to the place that God has already prepared for you. Now, that does not mean the road's not going to be a little bumpy for all of us. And it doesn't mean that everything's going to stay the same, and it doesn't mean that everybody's always going to agree. But what it does mean is that in the end, we will all find peace waiting for us. By giving us the Holy Spirit, God has given us all the tools that we need to do God's work. We just have to be willing to use them. Let's pray. God, we thank you on this Pentecost Sunday for the giving of your Holy Spirit that guides us and directs us and leads us down the paths that you have chosen for us. And even though, God, those paths aren't the ones that we have ever expected in life, we know that you always know best. We know that you have prepared a place and prepared peace for us in wherever it is that you need us. And so we pray for Bud and we pray for Cindy. We pray for the seven churches of this co-op as they enter a new time.